I don't know if all of my subscribers are Christians. I would like to think not. I don't hide the fact that I am. I love me some Jesus. Whatever you believe, I want to share with you one of my most recollected verses over this period of chaos and what I have perceived, and many others have perceived, to be deception. Bear with me, atheists, New Agers, Muslims, whoever you are, wherever you're from. Howdy. Now, beloved brothers and sisters, concerning the question of God's precise times and specific seasons, you don't need me to write anything to you. For you already know quite well that the day of the Lord will come unexpectedly and as a complete surprise. For while some are saying, finally, we have peace and security, sudden destruction will arrive at their doorstep, like labor pains seizing a pregnant woman, and with no chance of escape. See, whenever peace and safety become our highest priorities, we are done having influence as Christians. You can forget that ship. It sailed. Because we claim to share in the supernatural kingdom of God. A God who is all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving, wise, merciful, compassionate, everything. We claim that the world is demonically influenced. Yet, we are sometimes guilty of following the wolves of politics and entertainment. Politicians and billionaires and puppet officials, celebrities and what have you, as if they are somehow exempt from demonic manifestation, because a screen and a spotlight separates them from us. It's as if we dehumanize those in the limelight because we like their music or we like that TV show. Yet we may see a brother or sister in Christ who perhaps has backslidden or become depressed or skeptical, and we jump the gun and say, you need deliverance, you got a demon. Man, if we truly believe what we do about the powers that be and the fallen nature of humanity, and the ruler of the airwaves and his minions running the earth, would it or would it not be a fair thing to assume that the men and women who have risen to prominence in our culture, in whatever sector of society, be it politics or music, from Boris to Beyonce, need deliverance and salvation, just like we did? Would it not be fair to assume, given what we believe, that humanity has the natural inclination towards perverting purpose? We need to be consistent, church. And all of us, the people, need to wake up. We need to self-educate. My people perish for a lack of knowledge. School yourself. Question things. And what's more pertinent to this video, ask yourselves, am I truly free? Externally and internally, in here and here. Our very capacity for knowledge and understanding, let alone our civil liberty to pursue either, our capacity for learning, for love, for respecting and protecting life, for justice, for mercy and compassion, all stream through one faucet, freedom. Am I free to pursue truth and understanding? Am I free to love and to reject that which I do not love? Am I free to protect myself and my family? Am I free to protect those who cannot protect themselves? Am I free to object to propositions and rules and laws that are made and passed by my government? And will my objections be heard? Am I free to explore the facts? Am I free to strive for true justice, truth? Freedom of will is the essence of love. And love is the core of creation. Without freedom, we're pets. We're farmed animals, we're lesser creatures. And our lives and the conditions in which we live are dictated by those who are superior to us, in whatever sense that has been established, be it race, wealth, religion, sexuality. In such a society, our choices are limited to the wills of other human beings, and we are controlled, not free. I pray a prayer that I would encourage my Christian brothers and sisters to pray along with me for themselves and for the body of Christ as a whole, wherever you have been positioned. I continually pray for the Spirit of the living God to control me, to take every thought captive to the King of Kings, because He is not my equal. God is superior to me in every way. I believe it's God first and all else is derivative, and I believe that you and I are equals, deserving of freedom, because God gave us freedom, not man. Now then, why are we not more alarmed over track and trace? Track and trace. It's an alarming slogan. Wake up, China. I mean, London. As of the 24th of September, in England, some new rules have rolled out. Let's have a look-see, shall we? Customers in hospitality venues must wear face coverings, except when seated at a table to eat or drink. At a table. Because much like the game Tag You're It, Corona's not allowed to infect you while seated. But be careful, he's hovering around you, waiting for you to stand up. So be sure to put your mask back on. Right. Must be closed from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. Because Corona is a creature of the night and is more likely to interrupt your patronage in the early hours of the morning. And now the NHS QR code. Businesses will need to display the official NHS QR code posters so that customers can check in at different premises, using this option as an alternative to providing their contact details once the app is rolled out nationally. And this is the QR code we speak of. Oops. Sorry. Wrong one. That's China. What this app will do, if we're complacent enough to download it, is it'll track where we go, always, all the time, and it'll let us know if we've come into contact with an undead. I mean, a person who has tested positive for the T-virus, coronavirus. So the success of the app depends on its users having been tested. Let's talk about the test. The swab test. The one everyone's waiting for. The one they're lining up down the street for. I've seen it. Uses a molecular biology technique that risks false positives. That's what's been happening. It'll come up positive even if COVID-19 is not present. There's an Oxford professor, Carl Henningen, who's been saying from pretty much the beginning that we should not be using this protocol without revision because of the unreliable results. At the beginning of September, the government finally decided to revise the PCR protocol. There was no media coverage on that major U-turn, despite all the false positives they're responsible for, not to mention the fear they've caused. The most courteous explanation I've deduced is that the government is merely trying to save face because they handled the whole thing really quite terribly from the very beginning. Were it not for the initial test data, the faulty test data, we would have rightly concluded that the pandemic was over. What's happening right now then is that all of this is being blown out of proportion to allow the government to come out looking like they fared pretty well, considering the circumstances, the fake circumstances, even though they were the one who worsened the circumstances. Really, they just prematurely reacted. Now you might say, well, people are definitely falling ill and even dying. People are being taken to hospital. Mate, it's England in autumn. Of course people are going to get ill now. Tis the season. Let's move on to the rule of six. The rule of six is pointless, it's arbitrary, and it's unnecessary. It's pointless because without what would be secret policing or self-policing, there's no way to regulate or enforce this rule. And it's arbitrary because we're all still gathering in large groups, or groups more than six, at work, in school, at the shops, on the bus. And it's unnecessary because the recent surge in infections is being driven by younger people under the age of 50 who are only going to suffer minor symptoms, if any, if they haven't already had the virus, which is quite likely. And they have much less of a chance of dying of COVID-19 than they do of the ordinary seasonal flu. Just saying, track and trace app is potentially secret policing. Putting that out there, it's not an unrealistic trajectory. Let's all make informed, long-term minded decisions before downloading the app and thinking it's all right. Peace and safety. Bottom line is we're all different, but these rules are treating us as if we're all the same. We all have different strengths of immunity. We all have different underlying health issues, if any. Enforcing the rule of six is silly, and it goes against our civil liberties, as do all the rules that have been enforced so far. Having to wear a mask, socially distancing, which is actually not good for your health, shutting down the economy, implementing a curfew, tracking and tracing everyone. Besides, I'm sure many, if not all of you, will agree that the best way to lead is by example. Several MPs, Health Secretary Matt Hancock, and Boris Johnson, and his dad, have all been seen breaking the rules. Some of them more than once. Do you think that as our politicians are being chauffeured around wherever they need to go, that they're wearing masks in their cars? Do you think that they're social distancing, keeping to the rule of six, and abiding by the curfew? Our government is trying to cover up a bad decision. Well, bad decisions. Professor Neil Ferguson of Imperial College naively and irresponsibly told everyone at the beginning of this thing that according to their computer model, which is supposed to predict infection rate and whatnot, that we're all gonna die because this is a totally new virus and everyone is susceptible, basically. Now that wasn't accurate, that wasn't true, but Boris decided to plunge us all into a 4-5 month lockdown. There are four other coronavirus strands, similar to this one, closely related, circulating the population, contributing to the common cold. But Boris is still wedded to the Ferguson computer model. Hence all of the fear-mongering about a second wave. The stats are something like 30 to 50% of people having already built immunities to this virus, meaning they were not susceptible. That is the generally accepted understanding among clinical virologists and immunologists. These viruses have what's called circulating T cells. These cells remember what you've been exposed to and allow you to respond quickly to new but related threats, like COVID-19. With the two novel coronaviruses, SARS and MERS, we experienced one wave each. There's no underlining literature that supports the nonsense of a second wave. So for the love of mental and physical health, of freedom, and of the next generation, let's all think twice about the instructions we're being given, about the rules and the laws that are being passed, some of which under our noses, because of all of this. Because the thing is, if the majority of us courageously stand united against fake science, against arbitrary, unnecessary, damaging rules, we might win. If we stick together, if we have some integrity, some loyalty to one another, some loyalty to what is true, some faithfulness to the evidence, we might actually win. Now, I'm not a down with the system kind of person. I'm no Marxist. But what's happening here is we're choosing safety over freedom because fear. It may be a fear of becoming ill. It may be a fear of authority, of exclusion. You may fear losing a sense of security in whatever sense. Last week on Saturday, there was another protest here in London in Trafalgar Square. A protest against a second lockdown, against forced vaccinations, and more generally, against being controlled and having our liberties violated. I don't particularly like to subscribe to the vague notion of them, you know, them over there, these unidentified people in power. There are specific people, your local leaders, the Prime Minister, Matt Hancock, Sadiq Khan, people who are in influential governmental positions, whom we can appeal to, whom we can object to, because these are the people who are implementing these rules and these laws. These are the people who are supposed to be leading our country. So it's not a vague, the man. The NHS, the politicians, the health officials are all telling us that it's for our safety and the safety of our loved ones, that it's our moral duty to abide by these rules, to be tracked and traced, to be locked down for another 4 months, or for an indefinite period of time, to abide by a curfew, to not socially gather with your loved ones, with your friends, even though we are social creatures and social interaction actually boosts our immunity. They say these things. They say protect your loved ones, we'll help you. They're passing laws, they're deploying political policing, all just trying to do what's best for us all. Aren't they great? But the rules don't apply to everyone. Have you noticed? That on its own should give us all the itch to question the validity, the agenda behind the rules they are implementing. In the protest, an older lady, she was standing up on a chair and she was speaking, as you do at a protest. She was dragged down to the ground by police officers, and other such unprompted actions went on that day against the protesters. Now don't get me wrong, every protest seems to have this group of rowdy randies who are just there for the thrill of civil disobedience. Sometimes it's a really minor group, sometimes it's the whole lot of them. At the Black Lives Matter protests, people were lobbing bottles at police officers and they were shouting at them. And you know what the police officers did? They got down on one knee. They bowed to their oppressors. The same radical difference is seen regarding the COVID rules. Neither group of protesters took very much notice of social distancing and mask wearing and what have you. Yet one group were brutally shut down, while the other was upheld like they were heroes of the generation. I'll leave you to discover which is which. So my position, all things considered, is that everything that has been done so far is disproportionate to the severity of the virus. Disproportionate to the severity of the virus. Furthermore, the world will always be in chaos, confused and at each other's throats for one reason or another, because the world is run by the author of confusion. I'm not afraid of that prospect because I know and I trust in Jesus. I actually believe that Jesus is alive right now, and I believe that he is coming back. You might think I'm cray cray, but that's the truth. Some may think that's childish. I think it's a well-evidenced, well-established position to take, especially in the face of all of this adversity. Regardless on how we may differ in terms of our worldview, I dare believe you've listened so far because a chord has been struck with you. Maybe you're sick of the way things are. Maybe it is a hoax. Maybe we are being complacent. Maybe we shouldn't model our culture after Marxist ideals. You know, my final word to you is that the world will always fight for control over you. Your whereabouts, your money, your children, your purchases, your general beliefs and behavior. The world may continue to do this, but that does not mean that it may continue to do this unopposed. Side note, we all need to pay better attention to what is actually happening in our countries before it's too late, before we're just hit in the face with the consequence. It's the little daily things that we agree to, it's the small steps we take that matter. We must always, always fight to maintain our freedom and the freedom of others. We must always fight injustice. We must always fight against authoritarianism, even when it's dressed up all sexy looking, ready for date night. Smoke and mirrors, mate. We must always be wary of the things that we agree to in our minds and in our hearts, because that's where things start. I'm not saying live in survival mode. That's not healthy. I'm saying do little things. Little, realistic, achievable goals. Swap out your Netflix subscription. Send that money to help get girls out of sexual slavery. Object to your local leaders trying to implement a second lockdown. Support your local businesses. Support your area. Support your neighbor. Object to your local leaders trying to build a 5G mast. In a residential area, or in my personal opinion, anywhere. Because we don't need faster internet. We need to learn how to value each other. And you know, life. I'm saying we need to think. It's a dangerous game that we play when we allow ourselves to believe that the men and women who are in charge of our country, in whatever sector, have our best interest at heart. And if you're a Christian, pray for your brothers and sisters who are actually in these circles. Pray that they gain influence. Pray that they are bold. Pray that they are wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Let's choose what's right over what's convenient. Let's choose courage over fear. And let's choose servitude over selfishness.
Okay? Anywho.
Ugh. For those of you who don't know, my name is Christ Defender. I defend the Christian faith. I answer questions and criticisms of Christianity. And I believe that Christian apologetics is much more than theology. I believe it's something that needs to remain relevant to the culture. Hence why I make videos about Corona and Netflix and AI. Christians should care about these things. Alrighty. If you like what I do, follow the Patreon link in the description box and support me. If you're not too sure yet, subscribe, turn on notifications, and check me out. Alrighty, bye then. Truth matters. And you know what? Jesus explained, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes next to the Father except through union with me. To know me is to know my Father too. JC, the true reality. Get with it.